I call this hearing of the Small Business Committee to order. As Americans, we take great pride in our ability to innovate. Let's not forget, it was our engineers who created the Model T, our scientists who sent the first man to the moon, and our tech entrepreneurs who created the world's favorite new distraction. Yes, we can all thank Mark Zuckerberg for Facebook.com. From cyberspace to the healthcare sector, this country has an impressive track record of innovation. While the economy may be suffering, that pioneering spirit is still alive and well. This is largely thanks to our nation's entrepreneurs. If we have learned anything from the economic crisis, it is that the policies of the past do not work. We need to change the way that America does business, beginning with an increased focus on small firms. Those are the companies bringing fresh ideas to the table and new products to market. In fact, entrepreneurs produce 13 times more patents per employee than big businesses do. Much of that innovation is powered by research and development grants, the largest of which is the Small Business Innovation Research, or SBIR program. In today's hearing, we are going to take a look at that initiative. We will examine its role in spurring innovation and discuss obstacles preventing SBIR from reaching its full potential. Since first established in 1982, SBIR has helped launch tens of thousands of successful research projects. Every year, the program makes a $2.2 billion investment in small firms and infusion that gets 1,500 new companies off the ground. It also serves as the driving force behind our most inventive businesses. As a result of SBIR, we have been seeing breakthroughs in everything from antivirus software to wireless technology for blackberries. But the program doesn't just spark new ideas, it helps generate jobs too. High growth startups, the kind that receive SBIR grants, are prolific job creators. In fact, the employment growth rate for these businesses is nearly four times that of bigger firms. Meanwhile, 40% of all high-tech workers, from engineers to computer programmers, are employed by these kind of companies. The only thing more impressive than the jobs created through SBIR are the products that come out of it. Year after year, SBIR-backed businesses account for a quarter of U.S. R&D winners. And yet, it is clear that the initiative has not reached the full potential. The majority of products developed through the program never make it to market. There are a number of reasons for this, not least of all, being lack of capital. Innovation is a resource-intensive process. It takes time and money to carry a new product from the lab to the marketplace. As a result, entrepreneurs often struggle to bridge that gap. SBIR-backed firms should have access to all the tools they need, including venture capital. At a time when capital is increasingly hard to come by, it doesn't make sense to limit funding options for small businesses. It should be up to entrepreneurs themselves, not bureaucrats here in Washington, to decide how these firms are financed. Last Congress, the House passed a bill to modernize and extend SBIR. Unfortunately, that legislation never made it out of the Senate. With people losing their jobs and businesses closing their doors, programs like SBIR need to be running at full capacity, especially considering the role that entrepreneurs play in economic recovery. These are the businesses willing to take risks and help rebuild our economy. With the necessary tools, they can lay the groundwork for a better, more innovative way of doing business. I am pleased our witnesses could join us today, and I thank them in advance for their testimony. With that, I yield the ranking member Grace for this opening statement.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon, everyone, and I appreciate everyone taking the time to be here with us today about the Small Business Innovation Research or SBIR program. We have quite a few witnesses here that we'll be hearing from, and I'm just going to give some brief remarks right now. Today's hearing represents the beginning of the committee's work to review and reauthorize the SBIR program. Today, we'll focus on how the SBIR reauthorization can be better structured and its role as a vehicle in early-stage development of innovative technologies. This program is an example of a highly successful federal initiative designed to encourage economic growth and innovation within the small business community. Government assistance and funding can be critical to the startup and development stages of small businesses. Not only does it spur growth in individual companies, the program stresses the importance of expanding and diversifying research opportunities to small businesses. Created in 1982, the SBIR program offers competition-based awards to stimulate technological innovation among firms by providing government agencies new, cost-effective technical and scientific solutions to meet their diverse needs. The development of this program is not only critical to the unique needs of each of the participating federal agencies, but also to our national economy. Small businesses invigorate the U.S. economy by introducing new products and cheaper ways of doing business, sometimes with substantial economic benefits. They play a key role in introducing technologies to the market, often responding quickly to new market opportunities. Some of the greatest technological innovations came about from small business owners tinkering in their laboratories and workshops. The SBIR program provides these innovators with an opportunity to grow their ideas into practice, provide jobs, and improve our economy. I remain hopeful that legislation drafted by the committee will maintain the integrity of the program while not limiting participation. We must work to find an appropriate solution that funds the best science while wisely investing taxpayer dollars. The SBIR program's track record speaks for itself, and I am eager to hear the testimony this afternoon. With that, Madam Chair, I look forward to working with you on this issue.
Thank you. And now I welcome all the witnesses to this first panel. And our first witness is Mr. Esther Brown. Mr. Brown is the current Assistant Administrator for the Office of Technology in the Small Business Administration. The Office of Technology promotes the federal government's high technology programs designed to improve the competitive capability of small research and development businesses. Welcome, sir. You have 5 minutes.
Madam Chairwoman, Ranking Member, and distinguished members of the committee, thank you for inviting me here today to discuss the Small Business Innovation Research Program. I am Edsel Brown, Assistant Director, Office of Technology of the Small Business Administration. My office has responsibility for innovation policy and programs at SBA and for oversight of the SBIR program. The SBIR program, established in 1982, was designed to strengthen the role of innovative small business concerns in federally funded research and development and to utilize federal research and development as a base for technological innovation to meet agency needs and to contribute to the growth and strength of the nation's economy. This competitive award program attempts to promote innovation and commercialization from small companies by restricting a portion of 11 federal agencies' external R&D spending to small business. A National Academy of Science review of SBIR concluded that the program is sound in concept and effective in practice, meets its major congressional objectives, and is a driver of innovation and commercialization for small business. Since its inception, the program has awarded more than $24 billion to small firms. The program is structured in three phases. Phase one awards provide up to $100,000 to evaluate the feasibility and the scientific and technical merit of an idea. Phase two awards are funded up to $750,000 for 2 years for the further development of ideas initiated in phase one. In phase two, the awarding firm must either secure private sector investment to bring the innovation to market or obtain follow-on contracts with federal agencies to meet specific agency technology needs. SBA and the SBIR participating agencies recognize the importance of assessing the SBIR program's outcomes and achievements. The recent National Academy of Science study provided a first step toward assessing the program. The recent National Academy of Science study found that SBIR is increasing innovation, encouraging participation by small companies in federal R&D, providing support for small firms owned by minorities and women, and resolving research questions for mission agencies in a cost-effective manner. The study's findings highlight the SBIR program's contribution to job growth. SBIR awardees generated approximately 26 more jobs after SBIR funding. Commercialization. Nearly 50% of SBIR Phase 2 awardees bring their innovations to the marketplace. And small business reach. From 1992 to 2005, nearly 15,000 SBIR awards were made to small business. An example of a success story is ArmorWorks, LLC. ArmorWorks has developed a high-performance, low-cost composite armor system for the U.S. Marine Corps' new expeditionary fighting vehicle. ArmorWorks developed the composite armor system in response to a Navy requirement for a lightweight armor component that can be affordably produced and assembled. Since 2004, ArmorWorks has won contracts from the Army and Marine Corps to provide armor technology. The technology is presently being used to provide extra armor for protective vests worn by Marines and soldiers serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. Again, this story is just one of many. The story clearly illustrates the SBIR program at its best, assisting small companies to leverage their resources and providing the country with cutting-edge technology and innovation. Another measure of success by the SBIR program is that it is being replicated elsewhere. Countries from across Europe, Asia, and Latin America are establishing innovation programs based on the successful SBIR model. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. I'll be happy to answer any questions you have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Our next witness is Mr. Michael Koshuka. Mr. Koshuka is the Assistant Director of the Office of Small Business Program and SBIR STTR Program Administrator for the Department of Defense. The Office of Small Business Programs is responsible for developing policies to guide the Department of Defense efforts to meet small business procurement goals and objectives.
Thank you. Chairwoman Velasquez, Ranking Member Graves, members of the Committee of Small Business on Small Business, thank you for this opportunity to testify on the Small Business Innovation Research Program. I welcome the opportunity to provide a perspective on how the program is implemented and managed within the Department of Defense. Consistent with program guidelines and mandates, the program is used principally as a tool for the Department of Defense to seed innovation in our industrial base, and in so doing, develop leading-edge technologies with the potential to enable acquisition of lower-cost or new warfighter capabilities through the marketplace. Now, more than ever, we need to leverage the responsiveness, efficiency, and capacity to innovate of our nation's small businesses. By way of a brief overview of the DoD SBIR program, it is comprised of 12 military departments and defense agencies, with oversight and central administration provided by my office, the Office of Small Business Programs at DoD. This model of centralized oversight and administration decentralized management and execution allows each participating component to tailor the program to meet their unique and diverse mission needs. The largest three participants in the program are the Air Force, Navy, and Army, which together constitute about 3/4 of our overall DoD budget. The DoD program is the largest among the federal agencies. The budget for fiscal year 2008 was nearly $1.2 billion. This funding supported over 1,800 new Phase 1 contracts and over 1,000 new Phase 2 contracts. Interest in the program is intense among small businesses. For the past 7 years, the department has received over 12,000 proposals per year. The competition remains very strong, with only the very best proposals getting funded. Historically, about 1 in 6 proposals in Phase 1 get funded, and about 50% of those move on to Phase 2. The defining characteristics of the applicant firms have remained fairly consistent over time. Contracts are awarded in every state to firms of all qualifying sizes, and to a great extent to firms that are new to the program in DoD. Additionally, about 30% are awarded to small businesses under-controlled by socially or economically disadvantaged individuals women owned small businesses, the women owned small businesses, and small business concerns located in HUD zones. While it is relatively easy to identify specific SBI funded firms or particular technologies that have contributed to our missions, it is difficult to accurately quantify the broader impact of the SBI program on the economy. While in the course of administering the program, the department tracks the number of employees of participating firms, we do not collect data specifically measuring job creation. However, we can estimate job creation or sustainment by calculating the employment associated with both the SBR budget expenditure and reported commercialization. The market of these three activity derived from extended or logically concluding SBR funded work. DOD has collected this type of data for the past 9 years. Using a conservative conversion factor, the DOD SBR funding has supported the creation or sustainment between 9,000 and 16,000 jobs per year between fiscal years 2001 and 2008. While reported commercialization in the form of follow-on sales and investment supported the creation or sustainment of between 10,000 and 37,000 jobs per year. This estimate is believed to be conservative, as many firms that go to the program are acquired by larger firms, or otherwise do not continue to participate in this report to us. Additionally, they do not account for spillover effects of knowledge generated through the program that create an effect on the market activity. On the other hand, this process of jobs creation sustainment has opportunity costs associated with it and uncertainties also, and should be therefore considered with some degree of caution. Thank you for the opportunity to testify on the program today, its size, its scope, its impact to DOD. I hope my testimony provides you an understanding of how the program works, and I'll be happy to answer any questions today.
Thank you, Mr. Kosciuszko. And our next witness is Ms. Joanne Goodnight. She's the NHA, SBIR, SPTR program coordinator in the Office of Extramural Research in the National Institutes of Health. The Office of Extramural Research administers grants accounting for 84% of the NHA's $29 billion budget, including grants to small research companies. Welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman Velasquez, Ranking Member Graves, and committee members. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss the NIH SBIR program and the importance of technology in an economic recovery. NIH is one of the largest funders of the SBIR program and the largest supporter of biomedical research. It focuses on extending healthy life and reducing the burdens of illness and disabilities. The SBIR program is poised to fund early-stage, high-risk, and high-quality research from which important medical advances can be developed. This fiscal year, the total SBIR and SQTR set-aside is about $672 million. NIH SBIR projects are stories of igniting imaginations and spurring new discoveries that can make a difference in people's lives. For example, several companies in New York are focused on detecting, diagnosing, or treating Lyme disease. Altea Therapeutics, a Georgia company, developed a needleless infusion patch called the Passport System for painless and controlled delivery of drugs such as insulin or vaccines such as hepatitis B antigen through the skin. Three Rivers Holdings, an Arizona company focused on assistive technology, develops better wheels for wheelchairs. The smart wheel optimizes wheelchair use to root out causes of chronic pain on the shoulder, hand, or wrist. Lickenbrock Technologies, a Missouri company, developed a 3D imager that helps doctors monitor and treat diabetics for eye diseases. And a Florida firm, Biopsy Sciences, developed HydroMark, a novel site marker used in breast biopsy ultrasound procedures. Stories such as these come from companies all over the United States and underscore the importance of SBIR to our mission. In support of the goal to increase commercialization of federally supported R&D, NIH offers programs such as the Fast Track and Competing Renewal Award to help awardees negotiate the agonizing period between discovery and commercialization, the so-called Valley of Death. In addition, NIH offers commercialization assistance programs and facilitates matchmaking through the NIH pipeline partnerships. NIH is pleased that a recent study conducted by the National Research Council found that 40% of NIH SBIR funded projects are commercialized, further using a dynamic monitoring system to track continued achievements over time, we have found about 50% of our awardees have achieved sales. Other factors such as FDA approval, strategic partnerships, and investments also demonstrate program success. Economic impacts can also result from an SBIR award, for example, job growth, a theme of today's hearing. The study found that small businesses serve as potential sources of economic vitality and can be an important source of new employment as a result of NIH-SBIR funding. Companies hired an average of 2.7 full-time employees and retained 2.2 FTEs that otherwise would not have been retained. NIH attributes the success and effectiveness of its program to several factors. The most significant of these is flexibility in our administration of the program to address the changing nature of biomedical research and accommodate the needs of multiple industries and diverse product outcomes. Examples include the ability of companies to propose their own project ideas, an opportunity to resubmit an unfunded application, and the ability to exceed award guidelines in justified cases. Simply stated, one size does not fit all. Flexibility is critical at a time when science is changing rapidly, becoming more complex, and ever more expensive. Despite program flexibility and enhancements, we've observed some troubling trends. Specifically, the number of SBIR applications declined from fiscal years 2004 to 2008 by nearly 40%. Though the reasons are not fully understood, this disconcerting trend may be related to certain disincentives that are either rendering worthy companies ineligible or driving them away for other reasons. For some, the award amounts or current phase structure are not sufficient incentives for applying. For others, the process is too competitive. Others may have lost eligibility or be confused about eligibility criteria. New companies may find the process daunting or unsure how to match their skills with their research areas. Appropriate incentives can strengthen the role of small businesses in stimulating technological innovation during the economic recovery period. In conclusion, I want to reemphasize NIH's commitment to supporting small businesses and maintaining the integrity of the SBIR program. We look to small businesses to stimulate technological innovation, help us face new challenges, and produce benefits for the public. We look forward to working with Congress on ways to reinvigorate the program, incentivize America's small businesses to participate, and create an environment enabling commercialization of health-related products and services that will sustain our national economy. This concludes my statement. I will be pleased to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Ms. Whitman. Our next witness is Dr. Kesh Narayanan. Mr. Larry James. He's the acting SBIR STTR program manager in the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Science. The Office of Science has managed the SBIR program for the Department of Energy since the program was founded in 1982. Welcome.
Thank you.
And your testimony is quite important, of course.
Okay. Chairwoman Velasquez, Ranking Member Graves, and other members of the committee, thank you for inviting me to speak today about the Small Business Innovation Research Program at the Department of Energy. The Office of Science manages the SBIR program for the department and has done so since the program was formed in 1982. The SBIR program is regarded within the Department of Energy like any other program, namely as a vehicle for which the department accomplishes its R&D objectives. The Office of Science has a long history of using merit-based review of grant applications, and a thorough understanding of scientific and technical research are key elements in the department's program. Corporations throughout the department in administering the SBIR program is a key to the success of the program. The department issues an annual combined solicitation for the SBIR and STTR programs. Proposals are awarded to a rigorous merit process. Many of the SBIR awardees have excellent skills in science and engineering research, but lack experience in product development, financing business growth, raising venture capital, and marketing. Because commercialization of innovations derived from federal R&D is critical to its mission, the department provides funding for technical assistance, including commercialization skills. The National Research Council's 2008 assessment of the SBIR program at the Department of Energy noted that the DOE SBIR program has made significant progress and stimulating technological innovation in three important ways. One, by generating patents and publications. Two, by stimulating the transfer of technology from universities to the market. And three, through indirect paths, or, for example, through knowledge transfer to other related projects. In addition to the potential for commercial success, SBIR-funded innovations advance the DOE mission in critical areas. The lithium-ion batteries developed by A123 Systems, for example, have an unprecedented combination of power, safety, and long life compared to previous lithium-ion batteries. A123 Systems and Chrysler recently announced a strategic partnership whereby A123 Systems will supply the energy storage systems for Chrysler's first-generation EMVI electric vehicles. Due to low administrative overhead within the SBIR program, the program does not rigorously track job creation and retention data. The estimates I provide here are based on our own budget-related data for Phase 1 and findings of the 2008 National Research Council study that includes a survey of Phase 2 awardees. With almost 5,000 Phase 1 awards made since 1982, we estimate that more than 3,000 FTEs have been directly supported through SBIR and STTR Phase 1 awards since the program began. With over 2,000 Phase 2 awards granted so far, we estimate that about 12,000 FTEs have been directly supported through SBIR and STTR Phase 2 grants. In summary, the SBIR program has enabled successful collaborations between small businesses and the DOE R&D complex that have advanced the department's missions to improve the nation's energy, economic, and national security with new insights and innovative technologies while supporting a skilled technical workforce. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. James. Our next witness, Dr. Krish Nariman. He's the Division Director of Industrial Innovation and Partnerships within the Directorate for Engineering at the National Science Foundation. The Division of Industrial Innovation and Partnerships is responsible for SBIR and several university industry partnership programs at the NSF. Welcome.
Thank you, Chairman Velasquez, and Ranking Member Grace, and members of the committee. Thank you for this opportunity to testify on behalf of the National Science Foundation. The SBIR program at NSF is aligned with the NSF vision of advancing discovery, innovation, and education beyond the frontiers of current knowledge and empowering future generations in science and engineering. We recognize that over a third of all scientists and engineers work with small businesses, and NSF's SBIR program is well positioned to tap the innovation potential of those small businesses. We accomplish this by inviting proposals covering a wide spectrum of technologies, including agriculture, biotechnology, medical applications, manufacturing, energy, environment, and nanotechnology. Today, I'd like to share with you our efforts to spur the commercialization of technological innovation in small businesses and to help them grow employment and revenues. One very successful mechanism is our flagship supplemental program, Phase 2B, which provides incentives to find investors and strategic partners. We also encourage partnerships with other NSF centers and programs to leverage discovery research supported by NSF and academia. We are keen on workforce development through supplements and admit students and teachers to work in the entrepreneurial culture of these innovative small businesses. A key distinguishing feature of NSF SBIR program is that we are focused on assisting small businesses in bringing their innovative technologies to the marketplace. We are distinct among SBIR programs in that we do not procure any of these technologies ourselves. Let me share with you two stories of how our awards impact society. One is Touch Graphics, which was founded in 1998 to commercialize technologies, first demonstrated at the City University of New York. It has since grown to employ 7 people. The company's first SBIR grant from NSF in 2000, along with development of audio tactile interactive device known as the Talking Tactile Tablet. The product was originally conceived as a tool for teaching advanced math to students with limited or no ability to use print graphics, and has since expanded to broader applications. The tablet was awarded a gold medal in the 2006 Industrial Design Excellence Award. Under NSF support, Touch Graphics also developed a range of technologies for universally accessible displays and exhibit at science and technology centers, museums, other venues. In fact, the company is now developing talking touchable models for use at the Smithsonian, including a map of the national mall. This clearly helps the growing population needing assistive technology in gaining broader access. Second example comes from Divergence of St. Louis, Missouri, which is working to develop and market a safer method of preventing crop damage due to parasitic nematodes attacking plant roots. It's estimated that worldwide this parasite costs $50 billion in annual crop damage. This includes common U.S. crops such as soybeans. Divergence was able to take advantage of NSF Phase 2B funding, leveraging funds from Monsanto. This is a long-term research that evaluates potential nematicidal biomolecules in root systems rather than whole plants, saving time, money, and greenhouse space. Successful molecules are then tested in whole plants by Monsanto. I should note that NSF supported the original research at Washington University that led to the creation of this company. These two firms are only a sample from a very broad portfolio of NSF companies they are involved. With regards to impact on employment, the National Academy study of NSF-SBIR program and our own internal assessments indicate that our Phase 2 grants results in hiring of 1.5 employees and retaining 2 employees, which are critical factors in today's economy. In addition, we enable research and entrepreneurial experience for roughly 100 college students each year through supplemental awards. In summary, we are proud of the role NSF funded SBIR program playing in bringing technological innovation to the marketplace, growing their firms, employing scientists and engineers, and increasing global competition. Madam Chairwoman, this concludes my testimony. I'll be happy to answer your questions in a minute.
Thank you. As we heard from your own testimonies, SBIR has a record for funding cutting-edge research and spurring innovation. Companies that got their start through SBIR now employ thousands of individuals. I would like to hear from any of the members of the panel. How can we strengthen the program's ability to create new jobs? Let's start with Mr. Brown.
Again, first, the program is currently up for reauthorization. Mm-hmm. And again, we're all familiar with the fine work of your committee as well as what's taking place on the Senate side. In addition to the evaluation by the National Academy of Science study, the current administration is looking at what's on the table now, and considering what alternatives that we should consider and what would be the best practices as we move forward. And again, as I'm sure you realize, our administrator has only been there for a few short weeks, and we've got a lot of work ahead of us, and we're looking forward to working with them. But again, we haven't had a chance to address that issue.
Mr. Kushnito? The program is going to be up for reauthorization. So, based on your experience, how can we strengthen it so that we can create more jobs?
Well, Madam Chairman, I think the first thing I would focus on is what many of us believe is the strength of this program, which is its inherent flexibility in how it's implemented among the various agencies that participate. Giving the managers of the program at the agencies the greatest degree of freedom in the execution of the program in order to produce outcomes, I think, is the foremost thought that comes to mind for me, if I was to give some sort of guiding observation relative to my experience with the program.
Ms. Goodman. I just want to thank you for that question, especially given our downturn in applications. And so we appreciate the need to incentivize companies that are participating in this program. And as I mentioned, we don't know all the reasons. It could be as simple as the economic downturn in the biotech sector. But we actually believe there are other issues related to the current eligibility rules, certain aspects of the program structure. For example, companies currently who receive a phase one SBIR cannot move to a phase two STTR, and vice versa, companies who receive a phase one STTR, where they may not need the university involvement at such the requisite level, can't transition to a phase two SBIR. So there is an inability to transition between the two programs. The award levels have not been adjusted since 1992.
Yeah, I'm going to question that. Mm-hmm. So let me refer this question to you, Ms. Goodman. In 2005, then NHA director Mr. Zerhoni wrote in a letter to SBA that NHA aims to ensure that small business concerns with substantial venture capital company support in the biotechnology and public health R&D arena are able to receive SBIR awards from NHA. Why does a firm access to venture capital have such significant impact on the work that NHA does?
Because many of the projects that we're funding, particularly in drug discovery, drug development, even developing medical devices, those types of companies, in order to be successful, are going to have to attract additional investments, be it through venture capital or raising funding, even with strategic partners. And in order for those projects to make it to the marketplace, they're not going to be able to go it alone and are going to look for those infusions of investment. The same companies have other ideas in the pipeline, and they need to do that because many of these projects are going to fail. That's the I in the SBIR program. And so in order for us to be continually churning that innovation life cycle engine, the issue that we're facing now is companies who can take a lead product or drug molecule to a certain stage, but then may have other ideas that would be very fitting for SBIR, can't get the funding there, nor can they get it elsewhere.
Okay. NHA awards multiple phase two grants to small firms in order to help prepare the most promising research projects for commercialization. Of course, larger awards means fewer awards. Some have suggested that such a pattern leads to lower quality research and poorer results. How would you respond to that?
I would ask you to repeat the second part of the issue. Yes, we do provide larger awards when the science justifies it deviating from the $100,000 or $750,000.
And if we provide larger awards, that means that there's going to be fewer awards to give to other applicants. So some have suggested that such a pattern leads to lower quality research and poorer results.
I think that if companies are only submitting their mediocre ideas, I could understand where perhaps that concern is coming mm-hmm. from. There are projects that are, in the $150,000 to $200,000 range that are just as important as those that are in the higher level range. And so I don't know. I can't really answer that concern.
Occasionally, a small company may have progressed beyond the phase one feasibility studies of technical merit. In these cases, the company's research may be suitable for the phase two award. Do you believe that under these circumstances, the company should be able to bypass phase one
if it can certify that it has completed the testing and feasibility studies required under phase one. And I would ask for any of the other agencies to respond to that question. Mr. James?
Yes, I have a good answer.
I have a great answer to the last question, but I'll work on this one too. I think that our program would probably not adopt this idea of running a phase two without a phase one. I just see a lot of difficulties. I don't see how we would work it out.
Okay. Do you have any comments for that question?
I would agree with Mary Jameson mentioned it because we have an external peer review mechanism for reviewing incoming phase one proposals, which is very rigorous. And it somewhat relates to the first question in the sense that we have an SBR advisory committee, which is an external advisory committee, which has been looking at our program for almost more than a decade. One of the items they pointed out is the whole purpose of an SBR fund, if all they have done research and they're not commercialized and grown, it does not serve the purpose. So in order for SBR proposal to come in frame, they need to have a not only high research quality, but a high commercial potential ability. So one of the points they recommended, which we included in our SBR evaluation, is in addition to having external technical reviewers, we have included in the last several years external or what I call commercial reviewers. So the point being, the rigor that we deal with would be difficult to evaluate from outside.
In looking at how can we strengthen the SBIR program, we have to answer the question about the value of death that Ms. Goodnight made reference to. So it is critical that we see more research make it from the lab to the marketplace. Would a phase three grant aimed specifically at commercialization help more small firms reach this gap? Ms. Goodnight, Mr. Cosciuto, you made reference to that issue. So I think any additional resources, whether they're called phase three or phase two or phase 2B, are definitely critical in helping these companies bridge that gap. Because they get to a stage, at least for our companies, where the phase one and the phase two is only so much to put them on this pier. And they often have not progressed far enough to attract the additional investments that they need. Any other questions?
Yeah. I mentioned in my testimony on the phase 2B mechanisms that we are using currently to incentivize existing phase two grants to move towards the phase three. But one of the observations we have made is the ability to commercialize the examples I gave, for example, in the agriculture area. Sometimes it takes almost a decade before it goes through all the approvals, etc. And on the IT that area, it may be very fast. So even the phase 2B, we try to do it within the timeline of these 2 years of the phase two grant, but not all technologies are able to bring this third party commitment within the 2 years. So that puts some technologies in the blind, which may have leveraged this. So I'm answering not that we need more phase three special funding, some mechanism to that we can use this phase to be beyond the 2 years. Right now, once it's done, we can go back.
Okay. Mr. Brown, when Administrator Preston last testified before our committee on SBIR in March 2008, I asked him whether the SBA supported increasing the amount of SBIR awards. He responded that SBA was supportive of an increase and that administration has been working in-house on a rule to address that. Is SBA still planning on issuing a rule that would increase the size of SBA grants? Are there any other regulatory changes that you envision in the coming year?
Madam Chairwoman, in follow-up to your question and follow-up to the testimony of former Administrator Preston, yes, SBA has let that condition. However, again, similar to my response to the earlier question, the current administration is looking that over, and again, once they have a chance to evaluate it, we will be reporting.
I look forward to discussing it with the administrator. And now I'm here to
thank you, Madam Chair. Just to kind of follow up on your question, Mr. Brown, the previous administrator always expressed concerns about the role of venture capital when it came to small businesses and participating in the SBIR program. Does the administration have a stance, or are they looking at that?
Again, the administration is looking at all of the authorization issues, the size of the awards, the issue, et cetera. But again, as you know, it's a wide breadth of information and data they have to go through, and they're very challenging issues. So until the current administration has a chance to really get it under its belt, they're not going to chime in terms of their position. But again, in serving in this office for several years, I'm very familiar with the issue. Going back to our advance notes of proposed rulemaking back in 2004, the series of hearings that we had in 2005, so it's a very challenging issue. We understand the complexities of it, and we are evaluating it.
This committee is obviously very interested in that and how venture capital plays, and I hope you take the statements that have been made by the committee and what we've done in the past in terms of legislation and how we do that. I'd also be very interested in if you guys have any suggestions on improving outreach efforts in the rural areas, which have traditionally been underrepresented. Which obviously is an issue for me because I represent a very rural area. There's a lot of opportunities out there, I think. I don't know if you all have looked at that or just starting to look at it, if you have any suggestions, but I'd certainly be open to any of those.
Again, that's one of many areas that we're looking at, and yes, we are looking at it.
And you will have an answer by the next 2 weeks. 2 or 3 weeks. The program expires in July.
Yes, ma'am. I will take your message back to the administration.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I have a question for Dr. Dariani. I hope I pronounced your name right. Doctor, federal agencies do not have a strong record when it comes to funding women and minority research firms. You've instituted the research assistance supplements for high school students program to address this. Do you think other agencies can emulate your approach? And what do we need to do, do you think, to encourage more women and minorities to apply for these programs?
Dr. Obviously I can speak for the agencies, but I think it's it's something what you're referring. We call it the RAHSS program, the research assistant for high school students, where we encourage the proposal has to encourage efforts to bring minority students into supporting the research award that is going on. We have had even as I speak, honestly, we have had limited success. And we need to do even more public outreach and get our community to energize. So we're excited by what the opportunity is, what the possibility is. We find this getting some traction, we need to do more of. Can other agencies emulate other agencies and allow them to answer that?
I'll open it up to the other agencies here and see if you have any ideas of how we can encourage those firms that are run by women and minorities to apply for this program.
I'll just add something for NIH. We actually also offer diversity supplements, and it's my understanding that our SBIR and STQR awardees can use those diversity supplements to their assistant grants, but more importantly, I think it goes to Dr. Narayanan's point about the need for more outreach. And we have actually committed to doing a number of conferences this year that are specifically focused on minority and underrepresented groups. I remember back when there was the FAST program, the Federal and State Technology Partnership Program, and the Rural Outreach Program. The states actually were able to hold more outreach events and get the agencies there speaking one-on-one with these companies where they may have this intimidation factor to apply, but when they actually talk with us, they realize, oh, maybe I really can go through this.
What happened to that program?
It, to my knowledge, expired with the last reauthorization. I don't know. You want to put more facts in our review? 2005.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. I just want to elaborate a little bit, if I may. There are several supplemental programs which we document in our written testimonies, which attempts to link the SBR program with the programs at NSF, which assist the minority community, which include the community college connections, which include prominently minority research institutions. And these are our vehicles to make the connection to make the students and faculty aware of the entrepreneurial opportunity. One of the things our SBR mentioned, our advisory committee, and they formed a subcommittee on this very topic because this was a very great interest to them, this external committee. And one of the recommendations they came forward, which was very recently implemented, is a mentorship program. Because what they said is, you know, it's not only outreach, you need to really help them to educate on the, you know, put in high quality proposals. And so what we recommend, we are offering this as we speak, is to existing grantees of ours who are seasoned, if you will, and telling them, you know, can you reach out to the new minority, new PIs, principal investigators, take them under your wing and help them put together a high-quality proposal. We just recently launched. We don't have any evaluation yet.
It's going to be interesting to see how that program goes forward. Thank you very much.
Mr. Lucan-Roy.
Thank you, Madam Chair. With your reauthorization, your discussion of changing the levels, or we need to discuss it anyway, the levels, what percentage of your clients would require or could use additional monies? They come back to you for more, do you see you have to go out and get more, or what percentage could you actually use more? I think you can actually pretty quickly, if you can. Just a percentage. What do you see?
Well, what I would defer to my colleagues here, since they have the specific data from their respective agencies and there where the level needs to roll.
Okay. So, yeah, Congressman, it would be difficult to really know what that number is because we don't really track that sort of data, specifically whether a firm requests more resources or not. But looking at some data historically, for example, the FY 2000 year group, eventually, about 31% of those phase two awardees ended up being funded beyond the award guidelines in order to continue their technological development and increase their chances of success. What do you need to know? The additional funding met to their respective agencies, sometimes to different agencies within the department.
So you have multiple agencies that may work together?
That happens sometimes, absolutely.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That was my question. I was going to follow up here with each one.
Okay.
Go ahead.
For NIH, I threw a bit of basis on fact. Our SBIR median award for phase one in 2008 was about $151,440. And for phase two, $841,381. For STTR, the median award size was $149,711. And for phase two, $907,970. So if that's the median, I think that gets to the percentage or so that is actually in need of those additional dollars. there's statutory guidelines, and so we've been given the ability to exceed where it's scientifically justified.
So you're basically going above it pretty regularly, right?
As I mentioned, because they haven't been adjusted since 1992, we are at those mediums. And science is becoming more expensive. And in order for us to continue to encourage the most innovative ideas rather than those that just fit under the $100,000 or $750,000, we are going behind.
How do you use your discretionary budget? Is it the statute that allows you to do that, or are you going to have to ask me to get some waivers?
It's a statutory guideline, but we've also spoken and worked very closely with SBA so that they understand the areas of research that typically need this additional funding.
So the average award is greater than what the level of the award normally is, or should be statutorily done. Okay, very good. Mr. James.
A little bit like DOD, we don't keep really factions that we can give you some information. We did institute what we call a phase two supplemental a couple of years ago. Those are the opportunity for a phase two awardee to get another $250,000 in 12 more months on their phase two award. But they have to be invited by the program officer. It has to be, it has to show enough promise. It has to be important to their impact and their mission and so forth. And so the number of those, we fund about 150 phase twos. We might get 10%, maybe 15 or something like that. So that's the order of magnitude.
Okay. Thank you.
For us, as I mentioned, our mechanism is primarily phase 2B. We don't, our phase 2 award doesn't go up to the limit allowed. We really get a $500,000 phase 2 award. So we use the supplemental mechanism, phase 2B that I described, to go beyond, depending on the ability for them to bring additional third-party funds. And this, the need for additional fund is also strongly dependent on technology, since we are in a wide spectrum of technologies. Some areas, do not necessarily need additional money. They can go very fast to a marketplace. In fact, they try to go fast. But some of them require more time.
Very good. My time's about to expire. One quick question for Mr. Brennan. How many dollars do you have left in the program in the year with regards to the applications allowed to you, or do you have, or you have turned down a lot of applicants for these funds?
Again, SBA doesn't give out any funding directly. It goes directly to the agencies that are here, the other seven that are here. At the end of the year, I was speaking of the program as a whole. It varies from year to year. Sometimes there's an agency or two that may have a few dollars that would have gone spent. And other years, they send agency, they go over the threshold, so it depends by year.
This past year, up or down?
Oh, it's up. Up in terms of one out, that was up.
Okay. You more requested than you had available.
No, I'm talking about the agencies that met the threshold as opposed to those that didn't meet the threshold. I'm talking about, are there more applications than, but there's always more applications than the amount of money that's available to us.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Mr. Moore.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. You all have first-hand experience with the SBIR program. As Congress looks to reauthorize the program, what are some of the recommendations that you have for how the program can be improved? Some of the reforms that are talked about include increasing SBIR funding level and trimming by what's there. Increasing commercialization initiatives to provide a better bridge between research and development and connection with private sector partners. Improving administration of agency SBIR programs and improving outreach to small firms owned and controlled by women, veterans, and minorities. I'd like to hear if you have any response to any of those or any thoughts about those or others. I'm going to start with Mr. Brown.
Once again, the administration is looking at all these issues, and it's a mouthful, let's just be honest about it. There's a number of issues, and some of them are a lot more complex than others. Some of them are fairly basic, and some of them are a lot more complex. And not only do they apply across the board for the entire program, but if you even look at the four other colleagues I have here, they apply differently to the agencies that are here.
But in speaking in general, echoing what has been said by my colleagues, as well as what has been said by the National Academy of Study, the one thing I will say is that the flexibility that the program has now to be moved forward. So as we look at these issues in terms of eligibility, the visa issue, the guidelines, size of awards, whether we should reach the 2.5%, and other issues that we're discussing, can we just be mindful of how flexible the program has been in the sense that that is the one area that everybody agrees on moving forward, that we need to try to maintain that flexibility, while at the same time maintaining a structure that will maintain the integrity of the program.
Any other members of the panel have thoughts about that? Any questions? Any observations?
I would echo Mr. Brown's comment about the importance of flexibility in this program. That's really what's helped these programs succeed, given our varying missions. I think there is one area that is worth just sort of factually stating, that is that currently the set-aside amounts for SBIRN's TTR must remain separate, and they can't be combined into a total set-aside of 2.8%. So this gets more to the flexibility issue, again, of managing the programs effectively to fund the most meritorious SBIR or STTR projects under that set-aside.
Anybody else have any thoughts?
I think the table systems aspects of the current law that has made it pretty difficult for us to provide commercialization systems as we'd like. I think there are some efforts in the new reauthorization to fix it. I think we need to raise the amounts, and it also specified in phase two that it's not inside the grant. The government has the ability to have a contract to provide, so forth. And you mentioned administrative resources. Certainly, we would all like to have some more money to help us manage the program better. I think the prime example of that here is my colleague here next to me keeps talking about his phase 2B. And I absolutely agree. I think it is a flagship, and I wish I could emulate it, but I don't have the resources in my procurement authority to do that. It takes quite a bit more procurement specialists to administer that kind of program. And that's
any thoughts, sir?
I think from an NSF point of view, I echo what others have talked about, this flexibility, because each of us have a different mission, and you have seen some of the things that there's to be on. Because of flexibility, we are able to implement. One area that we have raised in the past, which is we are very fortunate that NSF, that we have dedicated SBI program managers from the topic generation to the evaluation to award management by technology topics. These are technology managers who manage the program. And the way we are structured is, you know, they cannot use the program funds to actually go visit or help the companies in terms of mentoring or making connections. So we take a reverse attitude of trying to bring all the companies to Washington, D.C., spend maybe 10 minutes per company, which is not really all that the best practice.
Thank you. And I yield back in 7 seconds.
Mr. Ellsworth.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I really don't have a question. I may use Dennis' 7 seconds. But I'd just like to reach out to Joe Caquito.
Caquito.
Mr. Handler. That was my first, my second guess of the pronunciation.
Okay.
I'd just like to read, Edward Sestak and I have been appointed to six or seven person committee to look at the military procurement system. And I'd just like to reach out to you and any suggestions you'd have to streamline that system, make it more efficient and more cost effective for the taxpayers. And you can contact one of our two offices if you have input in that. So with that, I have a direct question for small business, but I'd yield back.
Okay. So Mr. Sestak. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Thompson.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. My district's going to say that it's one of those rural districts that are out there. The SBIR programs just played a tremendous role, mostly
thankfully, to with Penn State's there, we have a lot of high kind of niche type innovations that come out of that applied research land. And so this is such an important program for my district from many perspectives. So, Mr. Brown, what are your suggestions to improve outreach efforts to rural areas that are traditionally underrepresented in the SBIR program?
First of all, I think we need to have better collaboration amongst us. I think we're doing a fairly good job now of interacting with one another and sharing best practices in terms of what the respective agencies have done. But again, when there's a best practice at one particular agency, we need to highlight that and share it with others. Another thing that we should consider is doing more outreach with the states. Again, we have four of the SBIR National Conference, excuse me, two SBIR National Conferences a year to date. And we always have a meeting of the state representatives. It's always a good networking session. You get key people from around the country that have the story from their particular state. And again, it's the same thing, sharing best practices, what you're doing in your state. You may find out that the state has a phase zero that they've established in their particular state. And I'm talking about something about the program itself. Same with outreach, what type of things are bringing about the best rewards for you. In addition, I also know that there are several states that are doing some very unique things. I know Maryland, for example, since they're one of our neighbors, I don't know if everybody in the county is Maryland, but Maryland had a very good program where they provided direct outreach for minorities in Prince George's County. It was targeted for that particular county to increase the number of technology oriented minority companies, and I understand they had very good results. And again, that's just a snapshot of the types of things that can be done. I should also add that with the program managers, we've established an outreach subcommittee, and we're exploring different ways of doing outreach as well as conducting the national conference.
Okay, thank you. Well, actually, my second question that I had would be the best practices, so I appreciate you getting into that question. In your opinion, what's causing the drop in the applicant pool for SBIR grants at MNH?
We don't know all the factors. We believe some of them may relate to the fact that some firms are losing their eligibility. Some firms don't see the incentive opportunities based on the current award amounts. Some are not reapplying, even though they have that opportunity to reapply if they're not selected the first time. Some may find that process very daunting, and this gets back to the outreach efforts. Those are just a few.
Okay.
I would add one more. I would say with our receipt date schedule, which is April 5th, August 5th, and December 5th, the community is asking a lot of questions about what about the August 5th and December 5th due dates, because there's a lot of uncertainty about the program at this point.
Okay. And some of those first variables you identified as reasons, are there any strategies in place to address some of those contributing factors?
With regard to the eligibility, I think that we've spoken enough about that and given how much we can say about it. We certainly believe that the current rules are excluding some companies who used to participate and are no longer. With regard to not feeling that the process is a daunting one, that gets back to the outreach and doing a lot of mentoring and helping these companies.
Thank you. And one final question, in my seconds. Mr. James, can you talk a little bit about your outreach to rural areas and initiatives to promote them?
I think we're very active in our regional meetings. We go to Johnstown, for example. We hope to have an outreach. We get several program managers from some of the agencies. Describe your opportunity.
opportunities for small businesses, encourage them to contact our program offices, encourage them to sit down with them on one-on-ones, talk to them about what ideas they have, try to find a pipeline in the department that would help them directly involved in those departments in their development. We probably do two or so every month with regional activities. Indianapolis, we do a lot of regional. I know we have an annual meeting, but we do our best because we think this is helping us get more applications, our applications. We certainly can't claim that that's because that's why our applications are going up. Obviously, our applications are going up because of the price of oil, for example. So it's something that we believe very strongly in.
Mr. Sestak.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. When we come out of this economy, if the modeling is correct, and things we've tried to do are correct, by about the middle of 2010, we'll be back at GDP level of 2007. But we've lost $1 trillion in our economy. And if GDP growth then begins to be 2.5% per year, which is what it averaged between 2001 and 2007. It'll take us 3 years to soak up the $1 trillion that we've lost, because that's what it shows the model. It's about 350 billion a year. In short, we won't even recover the lost cap capability if we just get back to the decade of growth of GDP this year. And this year means 4.5%. GDP Japan is going to raise. Go up 6.8% GDP. The point of this is that unless we are able to really energize our economy above its typical growth, we aren't going to make it in any real time. So I'd like to just talk about venture capitalists for a moment and ask a question if you don't mind me. Can you talk about a bit about what you think the impact could be if one part of this effort to try to not just stimulate our economy, we've got to get it going about 4.5% if we want to get back to being China's kind of competitiveness pretty darn soon. Can venture capitalists, the SBIR, can they play an important role in that? What, I mean, the SBIR isn't that large, they've got a lot of money, what's that impact upon their portfolio if they do have access to this? Because to me, it just seems like a real opportunity here for the common good to get us going and open this up again to the venture capitalist community.
The SBIR and SGTR programs, as you know, is probably not a significant amount of money when you compare it to what they're actually going to need to bring a product to the marketplace. It's the leveraging that it plays a huge role in. And so these companies who are able to get phase one and phase two and phase 2B, or for our agency, a competing renewal, and further their progress into some of the clinical studies that are necessary, that's when individuals become more venturesome and will start putting additional dollars into those projects. And then those same companies may have, as I mentioned, additional ideas in their pipeline for which the SBIR program is perfect because they have not taken them through that necessary feasibility study. And then we continue to see the dollars go into those projects and those that should promise get further along that commercialization pathway to get attraction of additional investments. So this is a cyclical process where SBIR has in the past played a large role. It has the potential to play a very important role for these types of companies that need to raise the finance.
So you'd be a proponent of it. If I could ask you, Mr. James, there has been some discussion that potentially certain sectors should be focused upon. Biologics, for example, from the start until you get that product out, there's about $1.2 billion. To your point, ma'am, about the cost of it. Should we not just let them in, but should we also try to focus this? I mean, people have been talking here about retooling our economy in the midst of things in healthcare and energy and things like that. Should should there be a way we look at it that way with venture capitalists, or just kind of leave it as it is? Because sometimes agencies kind of say, come here, SBI, help me do what my program's already on, rather than maybe being quite innovative and entrepreneurial. And again, I'll get back to the reason why I think it might be a good idea, which is, how do we quickly soak up the $1 trillion that we've lost? 2.5% growth is unacceptable for the next 5 years.
As you know, DOE has a loan program, and I've been trying to work on a loan program to get them involved in looking at small businesses and see what we can do to fast-track loans. I don't know how that's going to happen, but I presume your question is, do we believe that venture capitalists could play an important role in the SBI program? Is that what you're
saying? Should we try to focus it upon certain types of sectors? Most venture capital seems to be concentrated a lot of times in California, Massachusetts, and its demographics. But should we be looking at sectors such as health or energy? Or should we just let them in and let the cards fall as they may?
I think my experience has been that the venture capital community is not all that interested in our program. Our phase two is $750,000, and that doesn't seem to be.
If I put in one second about this thing, Ms. Goodright, what would you say? Goodnight, I'm sorry, project.
It's okay. It's important.
You understand what I'm asking.
I do. I'm trying to phrase my question from where I sit. So, venture capitalists, as I understand how they play in this game, they put their money into a number of different sectors, whether it's biomedical, whether it's energy, whether it's IT. It's where the hot technologies are, and it's where they see that they're going to get a return on their investment. Now, that may take a number of years, and certainly from the SBI, our company participating in the program, to get them to that stage. It is 5, 7, 10 years down the road. On the IT side, however, it's a very short turnaround. So it's a number of sectors where they are invested in. And
so you'd love to thank Andrew. Can you tell us some more about angels?
I believe angels are doing the same thing. They're investing in technology areas that are broader than biotech. Mr. Johnson? I understand you have another question.
More of a request and kind of follow up to my first question I had for Ms. Brown. I was wondering if you would make reference to the collaborative work that's going on. I'd like to request you to get a copy of the report from the subcommittee on outreach, and as it was described, I think that would be real helpful for myself and for the panel. If we could get a copy of that, please. Thank you.
Any other member that wishes to make any questions? If not, Mr. Knowingham, I have my last question, and I would like to ask that question to you. NSF is widely recognized for its effective administration of the SBIR program. And how has NSF been able to administer its program so effectively without a separate line item for program management?
I think to start off, we fully recognize that the SBIR program started at NSF, even before 1982, by Mr. Warren Pilbeck. So NSF had a certain degree of ownership to the program from even day zero, if you will. So that culture has resulted in the support from NSF management to staff our program with dedicated program officers who are experts in the specific technology areas. So we are, as I mentioned earlier, we're very fortunate that we have program managers distributed by broad technology areas from materials manufacturing to biotech to information communication technology. So we got this. I would say the dedicated program officers makes a difference, and those dedicated program officers, every one of them, I can say, everyone of the media industry background.
Thank you. For the record, can each agency tell the committee if they will benefit from a separate budget for FBIR administration and program management? Mr. Jones.
I think I mentioned earlier that we certainly could site visits, a whole list of things.
That's good. NIH also would support additional funding for administrative costs for managing these programs. Mr. Kashuki?
Yeah, we funded a RAND study last year looking at assessing the baseline overhead costs of the program. They came up with an estimate of at least 6%. So that indicates to me we have a very resource intensive program, and therefore I would say more resources are better than less.
Okay, well, and I guess that you don't have an answer since we have a new administrator and it will take 2 or 3 or 4 weeks.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you. I want to thank all the witnesses for being here today and for your insightful testimony. Thank you very much. And I will ask the second panel to please take their seat. Okay, well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Our first witness on the second panel is Mr. Joshua Green. Mr. Green is general partner with MD Moore WDAL Ventures. He joined MDB's investing team with a focus on clean tech companies. Throughout his career, Mr. Green has guided entrepreneurs and helped to build successful companies, including Yahoo, Tiger Therapeutics, and Vegas. He is here to testify on behalf of the National Venture Capital Association. NVCA is comprised of more than 400 firms. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Chairman Velasquez and members of the committee, my name is Josh Green. I'm a partner at Moore David Out Ventures, a venture capital firm in Menlo Park, California. I'm also a member of the National Venture Capital Association. And my views today represent 460 members of NVCA, which accounts for over 90% of all the venture capital under management in the United States. Like all VC firms, Moore David Out invests in entrepreneurs that have created innovative small businesses that will hopefully grow into large, successful enterprises. Our firm has been in business for more than 25 years, taking a hands-on approach to building startup companies in the high-tech, life sciences, and alternative energy sectors. As a clean tech investor myself, I am focused on creating businesses that will reduce our country's dependence on foreign oil and help preserve our environment while creating domestic jobs and more revenue. In
In 2008, venture capitalists invested more than $4.6 billion into clean technology businesses alone. They are innovating in a wide variety of areas. Many of these companies are founded on discoveries made through basic government-funded research. I am here today on behalf of those current and future companies. As an industry, we strongly support the reauthorization of the SBIR grant program, and we hope that the past inequalities are corrected so that all small businesses can compete for these critical funding grants. To begin, I would like to address several misconceptions that we believe exist and are used to argue against VC companies' participation in the SBIR program. The first is that venture-backed companies do not need SBIR programs because they are strong, fully funded entities. This is patently false. Venture-backed companies are quintessential small businesses. Many are pre-revenue and most have fewer than 10 employees. Like all small businesses, they operate on very tight budgets and are extremely fragile. Venture-backed companies must consistently meet agreed-upon milestones to receive continued funding. Venture firms do not have unlimited funds and have contractually finite pools of resources to devote to any particular company. The second misconception is about VC funding itself. Venture capital monies are used to build businesses, not to perform research. However, a company that receives venture funding may have other innovations in the pipeline that are worth pursuing, and it is for these new projects that the company wouldn't apply for an SBIR grant. Businesses must continue to innovate, and the current SBA interpretation forces these companies into an unfortunate dilemma for worthy new projects. This scenario has resulted in small businesses at best delaying important discovery projects and at worst abandoning this important work altogether. Another misconception is that venture capital firms are equivalent to large corporations, and therefore the companies that they fund should be excluded from consideration from SBIR grants. We agree that large corporate-owned businesses should not be allowed to participate in the small business program. But venture capital firms and their portfolio companies are not large corporations. They have private partnerships existing to finance the growth of an emerging growth company. At a time when the national debt is high and the government resources are stretched thin, we believe the federal government should look toward the private sector for solutions to our nation's health care, energy, and national security challenges. Instead, the current SBA eligibility rules throw costly, time-consuming, and unnecessary hurdles in the path of government agencies seeking to collaborate with venture capital-backed companies. We believe this is a huge loss for the country. Throughout the history of the SBIR program, majority venture-owned small businesses have applied for and received SBIR funding. This historical precedent strongly suggests that their participation has caused no harm to the program or other small businesses. In fact, the recent National Academy of Sciences study found no evidence that other small businesses had ever been cried out by the participation of venture-backed businesses. In recent years, as clean tech investing is growing, the venture capital industry has been working more closely with the federal government and key agencies like the Department of Energy and EPA. Those agencies have been touting the SBIR program as a mechanism to advance their research goals with promising venture-backed companies. The industry is poised to work with them. The policies enacted by this Congress, this administration, will either help or hinder that effort. The SBIR program is a wonderful mechanism for government and private sector to come together and do desperately what desperately needs to be done to support a strong economic recovery, help these small companies grow and innovate. But the SBA's past policies have seriously negated the positive impact of venture-backed small businesses. Venture dollars and SBIR dollars play complementary roles in financing innovation. One is rarely, if ever, a substitute for the other. We urge Congress to reauthorize the program with provisions that ensure venture-backed companies have a fair chance to thrive under the SBIR program alongside their non-venture-backed counterparts. Doing so, we believe, will only strengthen the future success of the program. I'd like to thank the committee for the opportunity to share with you today the challenges of our small venture-backed businesses have faced under the past restrictions and why these grants are critical to the ongoing viability totality of innovation and job creation in the United States. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Our next witness is Ms. Rachel King. She's the founder and chief executive officer of Glycogenetics, King.
Yes.
Glycogenetics has a specialized technology which is producing proprietary drug candidates that focus on inflammation, cancer, and infectious diseases. Mrs. King is here to testify from behalf of the Biotechnology Industry Association, BIOS, the world's largest biotechnology organization with more than 1,200 members. Welcome.
Thank you. Chairwoman Velasquez and members of the committee, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to testify today. And I want to thank you for holding this hearing and thank you for your support of the SBIR program and for your focus on this issue, because this is a critical issue to the biotechnology industry. And I think it's really very, very important that we understand the significance of the program, how important it is, particularly in this economic climate. And I do have some specific ideas about how we can improve it to even enhance that program further. As Congresswoman Velasquez mentioned, I'm here to testify on behalf of the Biotechnology Industry Organization. I serve on the board of directors there, and I also chair the Emerging Companies section, which is where we particularly represent companies like ours, young, early-stage companies that are focused on cutting-edge research, but which are smaller, optimistically viewed as emerging because we look forward to the opportunities that we believe our new technologies will provide. Our company has a lead program focused on developing a drug for sickle cell disease. We have 20 employees, and we do not qualify for SBIR funding. And that is really, I think, a clear example of why the eligibility program, or why the eligibility requirements need to be changed. Even more striking, though, when we opened the doors of our company, when we had 4 employees, we did not qualify as a small business for SBIR purposes. And that's because of our venture capital backing. So that's a critical issue, as far as I'm concerned, that we really do need to address. This is particularly important in this economic climate. And everybody knows that there's been a lot of challenges to many sectors in the economy. In the case of biotechnology, we've seen significant reductions in the venture capital investments that are going to biotech companies. We see increasing numbers of public companies that are running out of cash. And we see a real push to focus our resources on our latest stage most advanced programs, which really increases the importance of having SBIR funding for those earlier stage programs, which, as Dr. Goodnight mentioned, are the high-quality, high-risk, early-stage scientific areas where we really could productively focus some additional resources. We have 3 specific recommendations that we'd like to make in terms of improving the SBIR program. The first is to really address the eligibility requirements with respect to venture capital ownership. Again, giving you a specific example from our case, because we happen to have more than 50% venture ownership, it means that we do not qualify. And I think that that is a significant reason why we saw such a significant drop in applications, the 40% drop that Dr. Goodnight referenced in terms of SBIR applications to the NIH. My opinion is that that's significantly influenced by the fact that venture-backed companies cannot apply for those grants to the extent that the VCs own more than 50% of our companies. And remember, we're developing therapeutics, and in particular, companies developing therapeutics require lots of investment for long periods of time. And so we can't do that without the backing of venture capitalists. By definition, we don't have a lot of venture capital investment. And we really can count on the SBIR program, if it's available to us, to help us to fund the earlier stage programs where we're doing even more cutting-edge research. So it's critical to us to be able to access that. A second recommendation gets to this question of affiliated employees. And again, to give you a specific example from our company, we have, as I said, 20 employees. One of my large venture investors invests in all kinds of other types of businesses that have nothing to do with biotechnology. So they invest in a software company, for example, which has 100 employees. Those employees should not be counted in my eligibility for an SBIR grant. They have nothing to do with what I'm doing. I've got nothing to do with what they're doing. And I think we really need to focus on employees of the company itself. So the affiliation rules really need to be clarified. And the third recommendation, which again supports some of the comments from the earlier panel, is that we really do believe that agencies need to have flexibility in terms of how they implement their programs. different scientific approaches are going to require different amounts of funding, different timing for the types of funding that would be helpful to those ventures. And so I really think as a third point, to give more flexibility to the agencies and how they administer their own particular aspects of the program, I think would be very productive. So as I said at the outset, I think this is a critical program. You're able to support early stage important innovations. You're able to do it in small businesses and significantly affect employment generation in this country. I think it's a win-win for all parties. And I really thank you for your interest and your support of this important program.
Thank you, Ms. Key. Our next witness is Mr. John Stucker, who's the Senior Vice President of Fair Solutions for LinkTech, located in College Station, Texas. LinkTech is a research and technology development company with a 20-year history of successful innovation. LinkTech is a member of the Small Business Technology Council. Welcome.
I appreciate the opportunity to appear before the committee this afternoon and would ask that my full statement be entered into the record. On that objection, Madam Chairwoman Velasquez and members of the committee, it's a great pleasure that I appear before you today and offer LinkTech's views on the need to reform the Small Business Innovation Research Program. And I should add that I'm speaking on behalf of LinkTech and not on behalf of the Small Business Technology Council. It is true that we are headquartered in College Station, Texas, but some of us have small farms in Spencer County, Indiana. And we are the largest SBIR contractor in the state and one of the largest in the country. So it's fair to say that this program is an important one and has been beneficial in the past to the company. The company was founded back in 1989. Our primary objective is to intensify our efforts to transition technologies into the marketplace. Our technologies are concentrated in the areas of electrochemical synthesis, energy storage and conversion, chemical biological defense systems, and environmental remediation. About two-thirds of our contracts are with the Department of Defense, although we have performed under contracts to a number of the agencies that have SBIR dollars. As a result, our interest in this debate regarding the reform legislation is quite high, as our efforts to transition technologies will be driven by the framework of future reforms. In sum, and with all due respect to the participants in the past, we think that the debate regarding last year's bill as passed by the House is focused on the wrong set of issues. We believe that ownership of SBIR companies by venture capital firms should not be guiding our discussions regarding reform of the program. We should be looking forward to all possible resources, both public and private, to advance technologies into the future. The only ground rule should be that this is a small business program and should be closed to the activities of large corporations. We believe that the need really is on technology transition. There are a number of great technologies out there that have never made it to the marketplace, and in part because the technology readiness level of those technologies is insufficient to attract the attention of prime contractors or even acquisition managers in the Defense Department because they're not sufficiently advanced. And without having a clearly defined program to move from phase two into the marketplace, it will be difficult for those transition efforts to be successful. Currently, companies like LinkTech have to rely on a fairly ad hoc system to approach acquisition managers and to identify technologies that could be of interest and necessary to downstream weapon systems that they're procuring for the needs of our warfighters. And as a result, we find that it's very, very difficult to move beyond phase two into a phase three type effort, in large part because there is no phase three funding available to the acquisition managers to take advantage of our technologies. For example, we've developed a technology for producing hydrogen peroxide in the field. Hydrogen peroxide is an important element in cleaning spaces and equipment that have been hit with biological agents. Right now, the ability of the military to deliver hydrogen peroxide is through air transport and then having to store the hydrogen peroxide on site in the deployment area. Hydrogen peroxide is an extremely volatile material and it's dangerous to transport in cargo planes. As a result, we have a system relying only on air, water, and electricity that would provide them the hydrogen peroxide as needed in the field and would reduce the transportation costs and the logistics burden of providing that hydrogen peroxide and its current form. However, because of the long process in which defense budgeting goes through, it's difficult for our customer, and we have a customer clearly identified in the Defense Department, to reach out and take advantage of our technology because we have landed in the middle of the budget cycle. And so for them to look at us, they would need to put us into line for funding 2 years from now, in which case we would go 2 years without developing the technology any further, which means 2 more years in which our warfighters would not have access to our system. So we believe that the most serious question is our ability to continue the development beyond the early stage capabilities that you will get at the end of phase two. We have a number of issues that we have discussed with various players in this arena. We think that there's a possibility of having a compromise to go forward, arranging across the board, whether we're talking about phase ones, phase twos, whether we're talking about the level of allocation to SBIR programs, the size of contract awards, etc. We believe a compromise is not only feasible, but is possible within this environment. We're here to pledge our assistance to you and the committee, Madam Chairwoman, to seek those compromises.
Thank you, Mr. Tucker. I would recognize Mr. Lookmeyer for the purpose of introducing our next witness.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Mr. Rossellini is the President and CEO of Micro Transponder in Dallas, Texas. Micro Transponder is a privately held medical device company. The company is developing a wireless neurostimulation system for treatment of chronic pain. Mr. Rossellini is here to testify on behalf of the Advanced Medical Technology Association. Advanced Med advocates for a legal, regulatory, and economic environment that advances global healthcare. Okay. Welcome, Mr. Rossellini.
Good afternoon. I'm honored to appear before the Small Business Committee to share an example of how the SBIR program has made it possible for microtransponder to not only develop treatments for chronic pain, but a variety of other neurological disorders, including tinnitus, traumatic brain injury, post-traumatic stress, autism, and motor disorders. Taken together, these conditions affect over 50 million people in the U.S. and represent an economic burden of over $100 billion annually. Utilizing SBIR funding, in the last 2 weeks, doctors Michael Kilgard and Nasser Engineer have recently collected preliminary data that suggests our devices may soon be able to reverse the cause of a neurological disease. As a neuroscientist, every time I read that, I get goosebumps. This disease affects severely affects 12 million people in the United States, 500,000 veterans, 93,000 of whom have recently returned from Iraq. This disease is tinnitus. Tinnitus is a debilitating, constant ringing sensation that originates in the brain itself. Tinnitus is caused by hearing loss, often from trauma related to explosions. The VA alone is projected to spend $1 billion annually in 2011 in tinnitus disability compensation. We expect to move our promising treatment for tinnitus into clinical testing in humans within 2 years. We treat tinnitus by implanting a small device near a nerve in the side of the neck. The device emits small electric pulses near the nerve, which sends a signal up to the brain to produce chemicals that allow the brain to reprogram itself. When a tinnitus patient receives this device therapy while listening to a series of auditory tones, the brain is able to reprogram and eliminate the painful ringing sensation from tinnitus. If successful in humans, our technology will be the first time a neurological disease has been reversed using medical devices. It's a very exciting time for us at Microtransponder, and would not have been possible without the SBIR program. Microtransponder Incorporated was formed to commercialize Dr. Lawrence Collar's innovations related to a wireless medical device which interfaces with the nervous system. As a former Army medic, Dr. Collar had been inspired to use the wireless devices to communicate with robotic prosthetic limbs to replace lost limbs in combat. Now, I have an MBA, JD, Masters of Neuroscience, Masters of Accounting, Masters of Computational Biology, Masters of Regulatory Science, and an entrepreneurial track record in the medical field. But apparently raising funds for robotic prosthetic limbs and devices that can reprogram the brain is not a straight step to profitability. Instead, we turned to the SBIR program. In 2007, we received our first Phase 1 grant award from Joseph Pancrazio, Program Director of the Extramural Research Program at NIH and NIMDS,
to convert this technology into a clinical product. This award allowed us to obtain important data to show that we could power our devices wirelessly. With this feasibility established, we began to search for ways to use this technology to deliver electricity to peripheral nerves to treat chronic pain. At roughly the same time, a colleague and friend of Dr. Collar, Dr. Kilgore, told me about his idea to use the device to stimulate nerves to selectively alter brain function in a predictable and potentially therapeutic manner. Microtransponder and UTD submitted a research plan to the SBIR program, and with these funds, Dr. Kilgore's team has turned this idea into a potentially groundbreaking new therapy for tinnitus. We expect this therapy to be able to be used for bone deficit, post-traumatic stress, autism, and a variety of other neurological conditions. These SBIR grants serve a number of important roles in getting high-risk, high-reward companies off the ground. First, they enable the companies to inexpensively test the feasibility of their technology. Second, when a company is able to show feasibility and garner additional funds, this independent scientific validation of the company's approach opens the door for venture capital and private fundraising. After receiving our first funds from the NIH, we were able to obtain additional funds from the Texas Emerging Technology Fund. This fund awarded us a $1.4 million reward. The combined funding has allowed us to obtain proof-of-principle laboratory data and finalize our prototype device. We are now preparing to enter clinical trials at the end of this year for treating chronic pain, as well as possibly reversing tinnitus. This progress could have never been made without SBIR funding. Without the SBIR program, many high-risk, high-reward technologies would not have been developed, and the public would have fewer new treatments for serious illnesses. Chairwoman Velasquez and Ranking Member Graves, I thank you for your leadership in the reauthorization of the program and giving the SBA a very hard time about the lack of a commitment in this area. I appreciate the opportunity to share with you how the SBIR program has been instrumental in allowing microtransponder to move forward in developing treatments and cures for a large number of unmet needs. I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. If I may, Mr. Rossellini, I would like to address my first question to you. We heard how long it takes in terms of money and on time required to bring a new medical device to market. And most medical device firms need investors or partners to commercialize promising research. So in the current economic climate, it is extremely difficult to raise capital to transition research from the lab to the marketplace. What effects is this lack of venture capital having on the rate of innovation in the medical device industry?
My comment on that would be that venture capitalists are now espousing focus, focus, focus. So our device, if it works, is going to be worth hundreds of millions of dollars to a strategic partner. And so the venture capitalists would approach our company and say, the only thing you should be allowed to develop and work on is spend money on is a chronic pain indication. We can only use your device for that. What we've done is we've mobilized other neuroscientists to use our device in different ways. And the way that we motivate them is saying, hey, go after these SBIR funds. And so we can come up with further innovation in a non-dilutive way for other disease indications. And we've done it with four different disease indications. If we didn't have that opportunity, all of these innovations would have stopped.
But once you develop your device and you use the money from phase one and you want to take that device to commercialize in the market, you will need resources to go to that other phase. What type of resources do you think would be available for you to be able to move that product from the lab to the marketplace?
So our approach for the first indication, we think that we could raise venture capital. So for chronic pain, we think we could raise that money. However, we will not be able to develop any of the other indications without SBIR funds. It would stop. So we need both to develop the program that we would like to develop.
Mr. Stoker, much of the debate on modernizing the SBIR program has revolved around the issue of venture capital and the role that it should play in the program. So what are your thoughts on this, and is it the most important issue that we here in Congress should be focused on, or are there other pressing matters that we need to consider?
pressing issue is this whole issue of transitioning these technologies into the marketplace. My colleague here on the right is describing some of the difficulties they will have in attempting to move their device into the marketplace. There is no clear path, perhaps there's not only a single path, but there's no clear path within the agencies right now that would allow you to develop your device to the point where you could effectively present it to a private investment group of any kind and have them wholeheartedly enter into an arrangement with you to go ahead and develop that device to go into the marketplace. So there needs to continue to be a combination of public and private resources to make that happen. The affiliation rules that were devised for SBA programs in the past, and I don't need to tell you these, was largely directed at ensuring set-aside programs were not invaded by large corporations. Those affiliation rules don't necessarily apply in an era when there are multiple resources out there, and you cannot equate a private financial institution of any kind with a major corporation that is looking to get access to set-aside programs. And so we need to be able to rely on both. But our major problem is that there's not enough money in the base contracts. Those award levels need to be increased. The allocations need to be increased so that we can underwrite more programs with larger contract awards. And then finally, there needs to be specific appropriations for phase three development that would then allow you to move beyond the technology readiness levels that we're able to achieve at the end of phase two. The most common complaint I hear from the technical monitors that we deal with in the Defense Department is that we do not have access to enough money to really develop our ideas.
Thank you. In the biotech industry, investors often tie their funds to the development of the company's lead therapy. As a result, companies can be blocked from spending the funds from investors on other applications. If small venture-backed biotechnology companies could participate in SBIR, would more research be conducted on these secondary applications?
Yes, absolutely. And I have a specific example from our company. We have a program, very early stage, we think it's very exciting, where we have a family of compounds that we think could be useful in a number of infectious diseases, including HIV and tuberculosis. We cannot work on that program because we have to focus on our lead program. And we think our lead program is exciting and has a lot of value, too. And that's on the basis of that program that we've attracted the venture capital investment. But I would love to be able to support my earlier stage programs with SBIR funding. And again, to open that program to allow companies like ours to apply, of course, doesn't guarantee that we're going to get the awards. But I would be happy to let our science be judged on the basis of the quality of our data. Let the NIH decide, open up the competition, let them choose on the basis of the quality of the science, and on that basis make the awards, not on the basis of who owns what percent of our company. But you're exactly correct. If we were able to access that funding source, then we and other companies would be able to invest in more early stage, very promising research than we can do.
Thank you. Mr. Green, I can see you were here when the first funding was testified. And it caught my attention, the statement made by the rep from DOE, where he said that VC is not interested on the DOE type of industries.
It caught my attention as well. The truth is, it's just the opposite of that. In fact, I participated in a panel in front of approximately 200 entrepreneurs yesterday morning in Silicon Valley, where the entire focus and the highest amount of interest was about how to get in front of DOE in order to access dollars. Now, this is beyond the SBIR program, but the interest levels in participation, whether it be in the $2 billion that's looking at developing advanced primary technology or its SBIR programs, is truly palpable right now. It's in fact, as at least as great as coming up to say if they're in Menlo Park and seeking venture capital dollars.
Thank you. Mr. Wolfmark.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I don't have a lot of questions.
you represent the entrepreneurial spirit and what makes this country great in my mind. I'm excited to see you there, and I see the excitement and passion in your voices as you justify each individual company and the things that you do. The only question I've got is with Mr. Green. You made a comment that it's kind of interesting and treated to me, so that venture capitalists are used to build companies like your research. I think that really, if that's accurate, then it tells us well, this BI program can be really instrumental in helping get that first step taken so that down the road, the venture capitalists can come in and be able to be funds accessible to folks that continue to build a business. So I appreciate that point. If you'd like to elaborate on this a little bit more, I appreciate it.
Yeah, I think that just to dwell a little bit further on it, there is the conception that venture capitalists will take a significant number of their projects out directly out of university labs. In the case of my firm, about 40% of what we fund directly comes out of university labs. However, there's a significant portion that needs just a little bit of a more of a nudge to get to that commercialization stage. It's just not quite there and quite ready. And the numbers that, for example, are in both phase one and phase two grants is that necessary element to push it over the edge. It's very much akin to what's called seed funding in Silicon Valley, where you would put a small amount of money in order to get it to a commercialization stage. So this performs an absolutely vital function to get it to a point where you can then build a business around that data technology.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Thompson?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Mr. Green, picking back up on venture capital and the SBR process, obviously a lot of discussion there. My question is, are there other ways to structure venture capital investment contracts as to not include ownership, like a greater share of profits or sliding scale of ownership that corresponds to success?
Yeah, it's an excellent question. Actually, the way the venture capital industry has developed over the last 40 to 50 years has been we raise the money from university endowments and private foundations under charter documents that require us to take an equity interest in those enterprises. That's the way the model, that's the way the industry has developed. So, for example, even a slight change like taking an interest in a limited partnership agreement as opposed to a regular C corporation is something that we can't do in general, because we are constricted to taking that equity interest and enjoying, hopefully, that appreciation as the enterprise grows and the like. So it takes a whole sea change in the entire VC industry in order to do it in some other way.
Have you seen any movements in that direction at all?
I have not.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Stocker, your testimony mentioned that we should focus on ensuring that large corporations should not directly benefit from a small business program. I certainly agree with that. How would you suggest that we ensure that?
In terms of the rules that have been discussed in the past and some subsequent discussion that we've had with the committee staff in regard to how you would go forward, we think there should be a percentage limitation on ownership of any SBIR company by a large corporation. And we think that that's workable going forward.
Many of the recommendations that you advocated were included in last year's reauthorization bill. You know, what would you like to not see in this year's bill?
Well, I'm not sure that the allocation increase that we're advocating was included in last year's bill for a lot of different reasons. We'd like to see that issue addressed at least by the time the bill comes out of conference. And then secondly, we don't think there should be a complete elimination of phase ones. Phase one is a very useful exercise in testing whether concepts can be made to work. This notion of having privately financed phase ones that being asked to enter into phase two competition, I think that's an issue that we can look at, but I don't want to see us abandon phase one. Phase one is the incidence of failure is very high in phase one, but that's a useful result because it tells you you shouldn't be wasting your time in that particular approach. So we think in that context, the phase ones need to be kept in the program. We'd like to see more policy direction in regard to the commercialization exercise. We think the agency agencies need to be reporting back to this committee on a more frequent basis in regard to how successful the transition efforts are. I'd like to see the SBA's data, for example, that 50% of phase twos do become commercialized. That was a little surprising to me. I would like to see the Defense Department, as good as we've seen progress made within DOD, and for this I would single out the Navy. The Navy does a fantastic job in looking at technology transition from an early stage. The other services probably need to do some work in catching up to where the Navy is currently. So in that context, I think that would be important for the committee to include Navy Bell as a policy director in regard to this whole technology transition effort. We'd also like to see an appropriation dedicated to covering management costs. You heard the representative of the first panel address that. I've actually been in meetings with people saying they didn't want to review SBIR proposals because they didn't have time to do it. And people saw it as a burden on their already busy day of having to undertake an evaluation of SBIR proposals. So I think if there's additional management resources provided to the agencies, I think that would help them do a better job of being able to articulate topics that make sense to the acquisition people, to be able to do the proper evaluation of the proposals and to manage the program as it goes through execution.
An argument often used against venture capital involvement in the SBIR program is that small firms will lose day-to-day operation and control of their companies. Can you discuss the subject and tell the committee what impact venture capital investment will have on the management of a company like LeadTech, for example, Mr. Scott?
Well, one of the realities of private capital coming into the company is that those people who are writing the checks usually like to know what the company is doing. And so I wouldn't be surprised to see VC firms require a board representation some oversight of day-to-day responsibilities. However, I would also be surprised that VC firms would want to run the company on a day-to-day basis, because obviously one of the reasons they're investing in that firm is because they're impressed by the quality of the management team and they're impressed by the quality of the work that their firm is doing. To be concerned about venture capital or investment bank participation in any firm, be it small or large, I think it ignores the role of private capital in American enterprise. So I'm not too concerned about this whole question of operational control.
Thank you. For the last 18 years, the SBIR set aside has not been increased from 2.5%. Could each one of you explain your views on whether or not this level should be raised, and if so, how high it should be increased? And Mr. Stoker, you already answered my question, so Mr. Green.
Yeah. Sure. As I think about it, I do equate the SBIR program in very many respects to what a seed financing would be like. And there is a bit of a cottage industry that exists in Silicon Valley around seed financing. I look at that number as being somewhere around $1.2 to $1.5 million in today's world to get yourself in general to a point where you can figure out whether or not you've got a commercializable business to fund.
I would agree with that as a general rule. I think we're in an environment now where we want to adopt economic stimulatory policies for the economy, broadly speaking. And I think what we need to do is we need to focus the investments that we make in areas where we're going to increase employment and support innovation. And so I think to the extent that you're looking at trade-offs between, let's say, increasing an SBA program versus other policies that you're looking at in your role as members of Congress, I think this is one where you're going to get a lot of benefit for the investment dollars that you put into it. So I don't have a specific number in mind in terms of how much I'd like to see the program increased, but I would say that I believe added dollars in this program will have an economic stimulatory effect. I believe that will increase employment, and I also believe it will support innovation, which over time will lead to other further economic benefits. I wanted to comment briefly on the previous question about operational control of VCs. I think we really need properly to look at the venture capital investors as partners in the enterprise with management. That, in a good situation, I think that's how companies work. I agree with what was said earlier, that most venture capital investors, in my experience, don't want to run the company on a day-to-day basis. What they would really like to do is make the investment, get the regular reports of your progress, and then eventually reap the benefit of the risk that they took in making the investment. They can provide counsel. Often, in our case, I believe our investors give us a lot of benefit by virtue of their experience, their connections, their help. And I really think that we need to view them as partners in the enterprise, not somehow as adversaries in the enterprise. Okay.
My comment on that would be that 30 years ago, you called yourself a chemist, a biologist, and a botanist, and today, our scientists like to do frontiers, neural engineers. And so the amount of translational research and expertise that goes into the product today is much different than it was 30 years ago. But billions of dollars of research from consumer products like TVs and cell phones, we're taking these really interesting parts and putting them in the body. Well, that's a very difficult team to keep together. An engineer, electrical engineer, software engineer, biologist, neuroscientist. So for us, a movement away from the R01 traditional one scientist working on mind by himself into a way for a business to organize 5 to 10 different people that have to be experts to translate this medicine. So I think it should be increased.
Thank you. Any other questions, Mr. Thompson? Okay, well, thank you again, and we will continue to assess and to work and to discuss with the SBIR community the best way to proceed regarding the reauthorization and modernization of the SBIR program. So thank you again for participating in this hearing. I ask unanimous consent that members will have 5 days to submit a statement and supporting materials for the record without objection. So order the proceeding is now adjourned.